Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide, the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Albaugh. It is Monday, May 8th, 2023. Glad to have you along with another work week and back to school. Our producer and engineer, Mr. Aaron Zommers, on the board. Mr. Zommers, a rainy day here at University Avenue on the world headquarters of Civic Media in Madison, Wisconsin.
But rainy day indeed.
rainy May day indeed. Weekend, I thought it was going to be like this over the weekend. Weekend turned out to be pretty nice, at least around here.
It was for me as well. I was actually in Minneapolis, and it was nice there.
Fantastic. Just visiting friends, hanging out a little bit?
Some friends and I went to a board game convention there. They were going to go, and they're like, hey, you want to go along? And I was like, sure, why not?
Whoa, look at that. Mr. Zommers doing a convention for board game of the week. Look at that. You're going to be loaded up with all kinds of great board games.
Well, maybe.
All right, very good. Big show today. We welcome you all in. Joining us at the bottom of this hour, Matt Flynn, host of Matt Flynn Direct right here on the Civic Media Radio Network every afternoon from 3 until 4. Matt Flynn, of course, former chairperson of the Democratic Party of Wisconsin, also a practicing attorney. Matt Flynn is going to join us at 8:30 this morning. Going to be talking about this issue of the mass shooting in Texas, which is our top story today over the weekend. Yet another mass shooting, this time in Allen, Texas, at a shopping mall. Watched it unfold over the weekend on CNN Live. We're going to have a discussion this morning with Matt Flynn, and we're going to look at it from a conservative perspective. Former Supreme Court Justice Warren Burger had a great quote. Warren Burger, of course, a conservative, great quote on guns, and we'll discuss that quote at the bottom of the hour with Matt, get his perspective. I mean, the bottom line is, this ain't Oprah, okay? You don't get an AK or AR-15. You don't. It's not that everybody gets the gun they want. It's not the way the law reads. And remember, this is coming from a guy who is a hunter, who owns firearms. And meanwhile, you've got Governor Greg Abbott of Texas and people in Wisconsin saying, well, it's the mental health crisis. Last time I checked, mental health issues alone didn't kill people. Guns and bullets did. But let's take that for a second. Turns out that here in Wisconsin, Robin Voss and Devin Lemahieu and the Republicans zeroed out all the mental health dollars out of Governor Tony Evers' budget. All. We'll talk about all this with Matt Flynn at the bottom of the hour. Also coming up today on the program then, we're also going to take a look at a new segment we're calling Hot Air from the Capitol. This is a good one from the state capitol. State Representative Tony Kurtz out of Waseca in southwest Wisconsin, Republican, on the Joint Finance Committee. He came up with a bright idea. Let's make it easier and encourage our local law enforcement officers to write more speeding tickets. I'm not making this up. He wants to use that as a barometer. He wants to use that as a metric to determine if local sheriff's departments and police departments get more shared revenue, depending upon how many speeding tickets they write. So we'll take a look at that.
No one wants that.
That's what I think. But we'll take your calls on that as well. Also, we have audio this morning over the weekend. This is astounding, by the way, in hour number 3. Going to take a look at the Trumpster. Don't often do this. But Donald Trump's deposition, we'll just simply call it the kitty cat tapes. He confessed to this about grabbing women by the genitals. Remember that tape on the Access Hollywood bus with Billy Bush? Trump was deposed, and the tapes have come to light. We will have the tapes for you, edited for radio, of course. Donald Trump, in his own words, he mistakes another woman for his wife in a photo. It is astounding. Here's a couple things you need to know, though, today before we get into the entire show. First of all, weather-wise, across the state of Wisconsin, it is going to be warm but wet. Weather showers are forecast for the majority of the state for most of the day today. So you have to go out and drive around, take an umbrella with you or a rain jacket. Not a great day to be working outside. Weather will improve slowly throughout the week. We'll have the complete weather forecast details from Kara Foster from Weatherology at the bottom of the hour. Here in Wisconsin, a tragic story as well over the weekend. A Western Wisconsin, this is according to the Star Tribune out of Minneapolis. A Western Wisconsin sheriff's deputy was shot and killed on Saturday night. The third such on-duty shooting death of law enforcement officer in the region in a month. It happened near Glenwood City, 60 miles east of the Twin Cities at about 6:15 on Saturday night. The St. Croix Sheriff's Office deputy responding to a report of a possible drunken driver in a ditch reported shots being fired shortly after arriving. The deputy was taken to an area hospital and died there, according to state officials. Little additional information was available early Sunday, but state traffic officials reported Highway 128 closed near Glenwood City at County Road G due to law enforcement activity. According to other reports over the weekend, one according to Channel 3 here in Madison, apparently this sheriff's deputy had stopped to help a guy who had been in the ditch, tried to issue a field sobriety test, and the guy pulls out a gun and shot her. More gun tragedies right here in Wisconsin. We'll come back and talk about this and more. Also, Matt Flynn at the bottom of the hour on guns and what the law says. A little thing called the Constitution. Back more after this on the Todd Hallball Show. Welcome back to the Todd Hallball Show. It is now 8:15 on the Civic Media Radio Network. Along with Mr. Aaron Zomers, our producer and engineer, we welcome you in this morning. Here's the question for you this morning, folks. Do you think it's time for reasonable gun control laws? I'm just going to start with an easy one. Do you think it's time to reinstate the assault weapons ban for the 1990s? Let's just start with AR-15s. Make it an easy one. Give us a call, 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. How do you feel on simply reinstating the assault weapons ban? Had it before. Nobody's hunting rifle got taken away. Nobody's shotgun. Nobody's 22. Can we just start with reinstating the assault weapons ban and getting AR-15s off the street? Love to hear from you this morning. 715-388-7155. Another tragic story, by the way, out of Texas. Horrific weekend in Texas. This time in Brownsville, an SUV slammed into a crowd yesterday, killing at least 7 people and injuring at least 10 who were waiting at a bus stop outside a migrant shelter in the border city of Brownsville, Texas. Shelter director Victor Milando of the Bishop Enrique San Pedro Center said he reviewed the shelter's surveillance video yesterday morning after receiving a call about the crash. Quote, "What we see in the video is this SUV, a Range Rover, just ran a red light about 100 feet away and just went through people who were sitting there at the bus stop," he said. Victims were struck by a vehicle, were waiting for the bus to return to Brownsville after having spent the night at an overnight shelter. The city bus stop is across the street from the shelter and not marked. There is no bench, and people waiting there were sitting along the curb. He said most of the victims were Venezuelan men. So yeah, a heavy news morning. We will lighten it up in hour number 3. Couple of good mental health. Speaking of mental health, couple of good things to spend 90 seconds a day just to improve our mental health and attitude. We'll talk about that in hour number 3 today as well. But I want to start off this morning on this story in Allen, Texas. As I said, I watched this unfold over the weekend. Was preparing for the show, getting ready for some other things, and then all of a sudden this happens. If you haven't seen the videos yet, I warn you before you look at it, don't watch them around your kids. There's video out there that shows the alleged gunman, and of course we have to use the word alleged because to protect ourselves on FCC. But pretty clear on the video, this guy comes, drives up to a shopping mall right in front of the H&M store in Allen, Texas. Doesn't even really park, just kind of pulls up to the shopping mall, gets out of his car, pulls out what looks to be an AR-15, and just starts blasting people. Not long after, video and photos surfaced of the carnage in front of the H&M store in Allen, Texas. And I'm going to paint a pretty vivid picture of you for you. If you haven't seen the video, or the photo. A lot of people who listen to this show in rural Wisconsin are deer hunters, like I have been in the past. And a lot of us, after we get our deer, we take it to the locker plant. And particularly on opening weekend, you'll go register your deer and take it to the locker plant. And they're so busy that people come and hunters will just kind of pile their deer up by the locker plant door until they can take your deer, and then they put it on the hook and take it inside. There's kind of blood everywhere, just this, this pile of dead deer. That's exactly what this photo and these videos are at the H&M store in Allen, Texas. It looks like a pile of dead deer. Only they're not deer. They're human beings, some as young as 5 years old. Just a pile of dead bodies, blood everywhere, gaping open wounds. That's America today. Probably the strongest audio I can play for you to paint this picture. This comes from CBS 11 of Dallas over the weekend. Reporter J.D. Miles talking with Steven Spainhauser. Gonna have a couple of cuts here. The first one, and by the way, Steven Spainhauser is a first responder. Former military, former cop. He was the first responder on the scene, the first person there. And here is his interview with J.D. Miles, picking it up with Steven Spainhauser, CBS 11 of Dallas.
Spainhauser says despite applying CPR, at least three of the victims could not be saved.
The first girl I walked up to was crouched down, covering her head in the bushes. So I felt for her pulse, pulled her head to the side, and she had no face.
But Spainhauser says he found a child that survived while covered by his protective mother, who died.
And so when I rolled the mother over, he came out, and I asked him, are you okay? And he said, my mom is hurt. My mom's hurt. So rather than traumatize him anymore, I pulled him around the corner, set him down. He was covered from head to toe like somebody had poured blood on him.
It's that awful image that Spainhauser and others who witnessed the horror will be haunted by for the rest of their lives.
Because no one can see what they saw today and not be affected by it. It's not a situation that I would wish upon anybody, J.D. It's just unfathomable to see the carnage. It's tough when you see a family that's out shopping, having fun, get wiped off the face of the earth because somebody with a gun has some other type of issue.
There's the first cut. Quote, she didn't have a face. Did you catch that? The first responder on the scene rolled over a child. Quote, she didn't have a face.
Or that was the child's mother, but still.
But still. Yes, thank you, Mr. Dahmers. Didn't have a face. Meanwhile, you have Yahoo's over on our competing network, our competing station here in Madison, the Vicki McKenna Show, having people come on our show talking about the way that we survive. That we don't need gun control. What we need is simply to know triage and to carry tourniquets with us. Last time I checked, a tourniquet doesn't help when you don't have a face. Mr. Spainhauser was interviewed again, this time on MSNBC. And talking about, because what's happening now is, of course, Republicans in Texas. By the way, here's what happened right after the shooting. They held a press conference. And, of course, fine, the fire chief and the police chief were there, as they should be. Then they had the state representative talk. Then they had the judge of the county talk. The judge. And this wasn't to talk about the trial. This was simply a press conference, a PR spin machine for all these Republicans. And, of course, you all go back to, well, this is about mental health. Well, here's what the first responder said, the first responder, Stephen Spainhauser, to MSNBC.
I work around people that have mental health issues. This, I don't know what the gunman's problem was. I don't know his motive. But it wasn't mental health that killed these people. It was an automatic rifle with bullets. That's what killed them. I'm a gun lover. I have guns. I'm a former police officer. I'm a former Army officer. But these M4s, AR-15s, they've got to get off the streets, or this is going to keep happening. And we've got to stop that at some point. It could be you. It could be your family member. I never imagined it would be me. I never imagined it would happen in my community. But it did, and we've got to stop this type of carnage. And all the politicians are going to make statements. They're going to offer prayers and condolences. Prayers and condolences won't bring these people back. We need some action in our legislatures at the federal and state level for better gun control. And I'm saying that as somebody who loves guns.
There you go. Not my words. That's a Texan's words. A veteran, a cop, former cop, gun owner, saying that thoughts and prayers aren't going to cut it anymore. That mental health, blaming this on mental health isn't killing people, as he said. Guns and bullets are. You can say that mental health is a part, because, yeah, you know what? Anybody who commits murder, unless it's in self-defense, clearly has some form of a mental health issue. That's just a given. Let's take a look at a Fox News poll, shall we? Again, not MSNBC, not CBS, not mainstream media. This is a Fox News poll. Proposal to reduce gun violence percent saying in favor. According to a Fox News poll, this is from last month, April 21st to 23rd. 87% favor background checks for guns, according to Fox News. 81% enforce existing gun laws. 81% favor the legal age of 21 to buy all guns. And 80% favor banning assault weapons. Let me say that again. According to a Fox News poll, 80% favor ban assault weapons. More citizens carrying guns, according to a Fox News poll, 45%. Americans are sick and tired of this. We're sick and tired of telling our kids goodbye and going to school and not knowing for sure whether, I mean, of course, none of us know for sure. But knowing there is an increased risk when we send our kids to school, they might not come back. There is now an increased risk when we go shopping in a shopping center that we won't come back.
And it's the number one cause of death for children.
Exactly right. Meaning from 0 through 18. But isn't that interesting? That a Fox News poll, only 45% favor more citizens carrying guns. Meanwhile, 80% favor banning assault weapons. Love to hear from you this morning. 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. I'm just saying, shouldn't we at least start with an 80%er? Just banning assault weapons? 80% of the people in the Fox News poll agree with that. Because you know what's happening, folks? People like you and me, who own a .30-06 and a 12-gauge shotgun and a .22 rifle, who use it for hunting. All these other yahoos, these extremists, these people who go out and shoot up Bud Light with the AR-15s. People like this guy, people want to have military-style caches. They're endangering us for everybody else. People want to actually use firearms for hunting, to turkey hunt, to deer hunt, to squirrel hunt. All these other yahoos are giving people like us a bad name. And you and I both understand there is not a hunter worth their salt who needs an AR-15 to shoot a deer. And if you do, you ain't no hunter. You're a terrible shot, and you have no business being in the woods, first of all. We're going to come back, talk with Matt Flynn on Matt Flynn Direct. He's an attorney. Going to talk about a conservative Supreme Court justice, a former one, and what they had to say about guns and reasonable gun control laws. You're listening to the Todd Oddball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is 8:33 on a Monday, the 8th of May, 2023. Theme song there from Matt Flynn Direct. He's going to be joining us directly in just a minute with comments on today's top story, a legal perspective. What this means, we're going to take a look at the words of former conservative Supreme Court Justice Warren Burger. He had a very interesting take on the Second Amendment and what it means in terms of the gun lobby. But first, we're going to go directly to Kara Foster at Weatherology. Kara, turned out to be a much nicer weekend than perhaps we thought, but I'm not complaining. Got some walking in along the lake. It was a beautiful day yesterday. I mean, almost darn near perfect yesterday. Highs in the mid-70s and sun here in Madison. So we appreciate that.
Well, you're welcome. I'll take full credit. Right. Any credit you're willing to get. No, I'm just kidding. But yes, it was a lot nicer, I think, for areas. And that's kind of how this week is going to be. There, when you look at the forecast, you're going to be like, oh, no, there's a lot of chances for rain, which there is. But each chance is like 20 to 50%. And we all know what that means. It means, okay, we can maybe see a little bit of rain. You know, it maybe lasts for like 5 minutes and then it'll keep going, or we might see that a couple times per day. But it's not going to be a washout by any means. And every day is looking actually really, really nice. Temperatures are warmer, are advertised about 65 during this time of year, and at least going to be above that by a few degrees, if not up to 10 degrees above that in many areas throughout much of this week. So overall, going to be very humid as well. So we do have to kind of start getting used to that once again, as we do every single year. But yeah, I mean, a little cloudier for today in some areas throughout like the central and northern portions. Could see a little more clouds, a little bit of higher chance for some rain, including in Amory. We're reaching 66. There's a 30% chance for that there, cloudy. Rain showers likely in Wausau as well, getting up to about 56. And then over in Richland Center, showers and thunderstorms are pretty consistent throughout the day here, reaching a high of 62. They should clear up early this evening, though. And then as we head into tonight, we'll dip down to 49 over in Amory. We'll dip down to about 44, seeing those showers kind of continue, but it's 30% over in Wausau. And then those, like I said, those showers should stop early over in Richland Center, dip down to 46. Tomorrow, we will see that dash of rain, 20% throughout the entirety of the state, but a lot of sunshine. It's going to be gorgeous tomorrow. Highs in the upper 60s, lower 70s, barely any winds. Clear skies throughout Tuesday night. Still a dash of rain possible in the early evening hours throughout many areas, but lower 50s throughout the overnight hours Tuesday evening. And then same thing on Wednesday, another 20% chance kind of scattered throughout the state. Mostly sunny, highs in the lower to mid 70s. Slowly kind of climbing in that ladder. And then this basically continues both Thursday and Friday. It's basically going to be the exact same thing. Dash of rain, dash of sunshine. It will pick up a little bit as we head into Friday, kind of to a 50% chance. So it's going to be very scattered. So it's kind of annoying because you do have to, you know, think in the back of your brain, oh, I have to bring my umbrella to work again. I have to bring my raincoat just in case. But I mean, you're going to see a lot of sunshine nonetheless. Highs will stay in the mid 70s throughout the entirety of the state. And then the weekend does stay a little cooler, cloudier on Saturday, dash of rain. Oh, yes, I can hear you.
Okay. All right, thanks. Go ahead. Go ahead, Kara.
You're good. But yeah, highs in the lower 70s by Saturday. It'll cool down just a little bit. And then we're back in the upper 60s, lower 70s for Mother's Day on Sunday. But it looks like Sunday will be mainly sunny. You might see a little bit of rain, but I mean, it's going to be nothing different than what we've seen prior to that. So it's just a lot of scattered showers this week. Nothing too crazy, which is good. Nothing severe as of yet. So, I mean, right, it'll be pretty nice nonetheless. I mean, you're all just Kara Foster.
Thanks, Carol. We appreciate you. As always, have a great day. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Sounds good. Joining us now live, we appreciate taking the time this morning. Our colleague here at Civic Media and host of Matt Flynn Direct. Matt Flynn himself, former Democratic Party chair of Wisconsin. But in terms of today's discussion, and more importantly, a practicing attorney. An attorney for a long time, knows the law better than pretty much anybody that I know. Matt, welcome to the show. We appreciate you making the time for us today.
Good morning, Todd. I'd love to be on the show. You got a great show, and it's good to be back with you.
Well, it's good to have you back. Wish that we were under happier circumstances this morning. Talking about this tragedy in Allen, Texas over the weekend, where this guy gets out of a car at a shopping mall and just starts blowing people away, quite frankly, and talked about the carnage and how people are just piled up essentially like deer in a locker. The first responder, former veteran, I know you're a veteran as well, a veteran and a former cop, was the first responder on the scene, said the first person he turned over was a woman who, quote, had no face. Not a lot you could do in that situation. And meanwhile, Governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, offering, of course, thoughts and prayers, talking about mental health, which, like Republicans in Wisconsin, Matt, zeroed out the budget on mental health in Texas and, of course, here in Wisconsin.
Yeah, this requires, we've been talking about this for a long time, and Greg Abbott, the governor down there, and you may remember this, Todd, after the Uvalde massacre, you know what his response was? It wasn't about anything having to do with restricting assault rifles. He said that we are going to issue, and I'm not kidding, DNA kits to parents in our public schools so if their kids get shot, they can identify them. That's what he said. Now, this thing, the NRA back in the 1930s didn't even advocate that everybody should have a gun at all.
Mm-hmm.
Then, of course, it built up over time. We briefly banned assault rifles in 1994, and for 10 years after that, the incidence of mass shootings dropped 70%. Now, to me, I'm going to come out. People talk about red flag laws and all this. I'm with that 100%. But all we have to do, Todd, is say that we regulate assault rifles, AR-15s, AK-47s, like machine guns.
Mm-hmm.
You can get a machine gun, but it's the mother of all background checks.
Right.
And so if you just simply did that, get AR-15s out of everybody's hands, I think that would go a long way.
You are a former Democratic Party chair of Wisconsin. I am a 30-year Republican who left the party in 2011. So, let's give people the benefit of the doubt. They're going to say, well, these two guys, of course, are going to be against things like this because they're no longer part of the Republican Party. Let's take a look, Matt. I know you know this quote. I want to share it with people. This is from Warren Burger. Some bona fide conservative credentials. Supreme former Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, Warren Burger, said this. The gun lobby's interpretation of the Second Amendment is one of the great pieces of fraud. I repeat the word fraud on the American people by special interest groups that I have ever seen in my lifetime. The real purpose of the Second Amendment was to ensure that state armies, i.e. militias, would be maintained for the defense of the state. The very language of the Second Amendment refutes any argument that it was intended to guarantee every citizen an unfettered right to carry any kind of weapon he or she desires. Unquote.
That is a terrific quotation. Thank you for bringing that up. I had read it before. Now, Warren Burger was a conservative on virtually everything, mm-hmm. but common sense, what he said somewhere in there as well in that address, that doesn't mean that everybody can just get any kind of weapon and walk around with it. And he was absolutely right.
I know you're a veteran, Matt. I did not serve. I am a hunter. I've got a 30-06 I use for deer hunting. I got a 12-gauge shotgun I use for turkey and pheasant hunting. I have a 22 rifle used for squirrel hunting. I'm not against people having, I'm a Second Amendment person in the fact that I think that Americans should have the right to have these weapons to hunt and for reasonable self-defense. But who on earth needs an AR-15? And this is the type of reasonable gun control that I think that we need, Matt. And if people want to weigh in, either ask me or ask Matt, 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. Happy to take your calls. But Matt, from a legal perspective, as an attorney, someone who knows this little thing called the Constitution, I think that what the former Chief Justice Berger says here is exactly what we just said. Everyone should have the right to have a gun, but the Second Amendment does not guarantee everyone every gun that you want. It's not Oprah Winfrey. You get an AR-15. It's not that.
Right. Here's how I've put it in the past, Todd, and I'm with you 100%. Nobody believes that we should be able to own nuclear weapons individually. Mm-hmm. Nobody believes that we should own biological, chemical weapons, bazookas, javelins, HIMARS, shoulder held missile launchers. You don't want people renting apartments near Mitchell Field in Milwaukee and shooting down commercial planes. Nobody believes, because it's been outlawed since the 1930s, you should have a machine gun unless you go through the mother of all background checks. Suddenly, the current AR-15, AK-47 assault rifles are more lethal than machine guns in the 1930s. They really are, especially when they have bump stocks and they alter them and all this sort of thing, and 18-year-olds get hold of them. And I think that that has got to be stopped. I think that assault rifles are unnecessary, and if you really think you need one like a machine gun, go through the mother of all background checks. And I mean that. You're going to go down there, and you're not going to get it in all likelihood.
But when you look at the Second Amendment, Matt, you're one person, you're one attorney, but it's correct. What Chief Berger said here is has legal foundation, does it not? That the Second Amendment is the interpretation that everybody gets everything, it's just simply incorrect.
Yeah, it is incorrect. But let me give you a very quickly deeper historical perspective.
Please.
In the Second Amendment was a liberal amendment. By that I mean in the Middle Ages, the peasants were forbidden from having weapons. And the king would kill you if you were a peasant and you were found with a sword. So at Washington and the Founding Fathers said, no, we are a free people. And they did talk about a militia, but there were guys with hunting rifles and cabins in Kentucky. What the hell? However, and they needed it for food. Mm-hmm. However, nobody says that they should have a nuclear weapon, a machine gun, a shoulder-held missile launcher, a chemical weapon, or a frankly, an assault rifle. We got to draw the line, and I draw it in assault rifles. I agree with you 100%.
Heather Cox Richardson, a great author, she has an article, Letters from American, May 6th of this year. I'm not going to read the whole article. A couple of things she says. Two instances that the Second Amendment gives individuals a broad right to own guns comes from two places. One, the establishment of the National Rifle Association in New York in 1871, but then perhaps more importantly, the second thing that led us to where we are today, she writes, is leaders of the NRA embraced the politics of movement conservatism, the political movement that rose to combat the business regulations and social welfare programs. Both Democrats and Republicans embraced the World War II. And she writes that in 1972, the Republican platform called for gun control to restrict the sale of quote-unquote cheap handguns. But in 1975, as he geared up to challenge President Gerald R. Ford in the 76th presidential nomination, movement conservative hero Ronald Reagan took a stand against gun control in 1980. And that's where a lot of things changed, Matt.
Yeah, you make a very, very good point. The Republican Party, and Warren Burger was an example. He was the Chief Justice in the early 70s. But it did end with Ronald Reagan. It was for political advantage. And people thought, oh, great, you know, I can have a gun now. And they don't differentiate between an assault rifle and a handgun, or as you are, you're a hunter. You're a good hunter. And you have several weapons, and you should. You respect the weapon. I mean, now you have permitless carry in Florida and Texas. Any 18-year-old can go into a parking lot and there's a guy in a raincoat at a gun show and get an AR-15, doesn't even know how to fire it. This is wrong and it's stupid and it's contrary to the Second Amendment, in my view.
Here's what Texas Governor Greg Abbott tweeted earlier this year. And Eric Sewell, the congressman, is kind of trolling the governor on this. This is a direct quote from Abbott. Quote, I'm embarrassed. Texas, number two in the nation for new gun purchases, behind California, all in caps. Let's pick up the pace, Texans. And then he includes a link to the NRA. And I want to make clear, that wasn't last night. This was a tweet from a while back. But I mean, yeah. This is Abbott's attitude, Matt.
Well, the thing about Abbott is all he cares about is reelection, and he has so divided his state, and it's divided for a lot of reasons, for instance, immigration. And one of the things that isn't commented on enough is that as long as this country had fewer minorities in it, quite frankly, I mean, to put it very, very bluntly, people were not as concerned about owning guns. I mean, very bluntly. Mm-hmm. But ever since the immigration reforms in the mid-60s and then ever since the increased immigration, a lot of people want to own guns, even though they'll never use them and they don't need them. And a lot of the newcomers are hard workers. So that is a psychological thing going on. But Abbott can't be trusted. He just flat out can't be trusted.
Stay with us more, Matt Flynn. Matt Flynn, direct after this. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network.
Backbiter, tell him that God's gonna cut you down. Tell him that God's gonna cut you down. Tell him that God's gonna cut you down.
The Todd Allball Show. It is now 8:50 on the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to be joined by our colleague, Matt Flynn of Matt Flynn Direct. You can hear the great program every afternoon from 3 until 4. He gets right into it. All callers taken. He has a great tagline. You're not woke if you don't know history. And it's so true, Matt. I mean, if we don't take a look at how the NRA formed, how it was, I bet you that most folks, most hunters in Wisconsin, if you said, did you realize that the the Republican Party supported gun control in 1972? Most of them wouldn't realize that.
Right. They wouldn't believe it. And the other thing I've told people and they still don't believe is the NRA leadership is cozy with the Russian leadership. They go over, they go over to Moscow and they hang out with them. Everybody should understand something. Guns are illegal in Russia, all guns. If a citizen had a gun, they'll arrest him and beat the hell out of him. Why is the NRA leadership hanging around with the Russian leadership? I don't think the NRA leadership cares about gun rights at all. They're using it as part of ultra-movement conservatism to get power in a different way. I mean, I really think that's what's going on. And frankly, I mean, there have been allegations of misuse of money by the leadership of the NRA. And the NRA is not what it was 50 years ago. It just flat out isn't.
I've told this story. I won't tell the whole thing on the air just for a matter of time. When I worked for former state senator Dale Schultz, and when he was Senate majority leader, I had the great displeasure of meeting Wayne LaPierre, head of the NRA, in person.
Wow.
And I'm not making this up, Matt. It is the only time in my life that I actually felt evil around me. My skin, I'm not making that up. I mean, I'm not joking. My skin was just kind of creepy. And you know what? We got back in my boss's truck, and he said the same thing. It was just this palpable sense that something is wrong, something's not right. This guy is unhinged. To your point, this is a guy who has gone to Moscow and met with Putin, and so people ought to think about that.
Well, Dale Schultz is a guy I have great respect for, and I think that is a terrific thing. You work for him in a senior capacity. And I agree with Wayne LaPierre. There's a hatred that emanates from him. And when he threatened Obama, it was almost semi-violent, if you took a look at some of the clips. That's what the leadership is like now, which was not the NRA 50 years ago, 60. It really was not.
No.
And the bottom line is people should have guns. That's fine. But they shouldn't have machine guns. And therefore, they shouldn't have AR-15s. And for everybody out there who thinks, oh, well, you know, they're just semi-automatic, let me tell you something. There are a lot of hunting rifles that are semi-automatic. That's fine. They fire 3 or 4 shots. But you can have a big magazine, and then you have a bump stock, and you can convert easily or, in fact, technically use an AR-15 with the lethal efficiency of a machine gun in the 1930s. I mean, you can.
Right.
That should be regulated like a machine gun.
That's what my viewpoint is. Let's start with AR-15s. Let's start with assault rifles. And let's start there. And let's enforce the laws in the book. And by the way, as we said, for all the Republicans that wanted to talk about this is a mental health issue, well, yeah, unless you're in self-defense, if you kill somebody, last time I checked, you probably have a mental health issue. You know, normal, sane people don't kill other people, all right? So let's start there. But then let's just take them at their word. Then why the world does Robin Voss and Devin Lemieux cut Governor Evers' proposed budget on mental health down to nothing?
Right. In other words, that's a fig leaf. And not only that, you may remember they had Brad Pfaff in there as the agricultural secretary briefly by appointment, and they refused to confirm him because he had advocated a small amount of mental health for farmers. I mean, that was the reason that they were going to shoot down him. They don't give a damn about mental health. No. They use it as a fig leaf.
Death by suicide in the farming community, agriculture, is at or near an all-time high. And people don't want to talk about that.
And that's right. Go ahead.
I was going to say, that's another thing. That's another reason why Governor Evers put that mental health money in there.
Right. And the thing is, how people can't pick up on this. In other words, yeah, mental health is a problem. And for the people that have an AR-15 and go into a classroom and kill 20 kids in the second grade, yeah, they're mentally ill. They should not have had an assault rifle in the first place.
Exactly.
That was outlawed in 1994, and we saw a 70% drop in mass killings till 2004, and the Republicans under Bush put it back in.
And by the way, my other former boss, Scott Klug, voted, one of the few Republicans that voted for that assault weapons ban, represented Madison in southern Wisconsin, a Republican, voted for it back in the mid-90s.
Yeah, he was a good man, too. That was
Before I let you go, Matt, a couple of 3 minutes here. This issue on the University of Madison campus, we had a white student. She apparently, from my reporting, broke up with a black boyfriend, then got inebriated and picked up her phone and put on social media some horrific, terrible, sickening things, using the N-word, saying that black people should go back to the cotton fields, quote-unquote. I mean, just disgusting, despicable stuff. The students at UW Madison have rallied. They had sitting on the streets here around campus. They've gone to the chancellor's office demanding that this student be expelled. Explain to people why, as horrific as that is, under something called the Constitution, just not possible.
Right. It would be unconstitutional, illegal, for Madison to expel anybody for anything they privately posted on social media. That said, I got to tell you, when you have thousands of students demonstrating, that girl, quite frankly, will be driven out by a mob. I mean, that's really what's going on. She can't safely go down State Street to a bar and hang out, and that's not going to happen. But a mob, looking in Stanford, a conservative judge went in to speak, and they shouted, "Your daughter should be raped." And the head of diversity, equity, and inclusion, the dean, said, "Is the juice worth the squeeze? Is the juice worth the squeeze?" Well, and this guy didn't post anything. He just wrote some conservative opinions. There's a lot of that going on in the universities, and it's a shame.
But the point is, under the Constitution, and by the way, I repudiate, and her comments are deplorable, and she has no business being there. But simply from the university standpoint, it's important for people to understand that legally, under the First Amendment, she simply can't be expelled just for what she said, because people, no matter how bad it is, as long as you're not threatening someone, people have the right to say despicable things in this country.
She came close to that line.
This is America. This is America, and that is the truth, and that is the law, and it's really based on the French Enlightenment. Voltaire once said, I hate what you said, but I'll die for your right to say it. Now, that was an extreme statement, but what's going on here is, if you start... This is clearly speech that is repugnant, and thousands of people have demonstrated. But, then what comes is, there's more narrow speech, like this judge in Stanford, and they shout his daughter should be raped. And I've been to Madison. I'm a graduate of UW Law School, by the way, in Madison, a great law school.
Yep.
And I've seen on telephone polls these stickers that say rally against the speaker. And it's just a kind of a, run-of-the-mill type speaker who's a conservative. That is happening. Some of the universities are becoming identity politics mosh pits. They really are. So this particular thing is reprehensible and wrong, and I think she'll be driven out by a mob. But you're right. The university under the First Amendment can't prohibit speech.
And meanwhile, Robin Voss wants to get rid of the diversity and inclusion part of the university. No problem here, Mr. Voss. No problem at all. What a joke. Got 15 seconds. What's coming up on your show today?
Well, today we got a lot of stuff, and I'll tell you what, one of them is the debt limit, and the other one is Russia and Ukraine.
Can't wait.
So, Todd, I love being on your show. You got a great show.
You as well. 3 o'clock this afternoon on Civic Media. Matt Flynn back after this on the top.